There is one narrative which is even more compelling and interesting than the drama, the political, social, economic life drama of this world, and that is going beyond the spiritual words and concepts to actually experiencing what it's pointing to. That is the most compelling narrative there is. And nothing even comes close. So we might as well be good, really, really tuned into that narrative. Might as well be tuned into that narrative. And that's what we're doing here. We're tuning in to that narrative. Yes, it is a journey beyond words. And most importantly, it's a journey beyond spiritual words and spiritual concepts as well. We have to, you know, get over our clinging to that as well. No matter how lofty the concepts may appear to be, we have to ultimately go beyond that. Go beyond that. And so this is what our focus is, going beyond this. And the narrative of this and working on it is way more compelling, actually. And this is something that we need to renew this realization every day, because in the world there's always these riots and these earthquakes, and you know, there's all this drama going on, not to mention the takeover, this hostile takeover of this planet, which, by the way, those who are moaning and complaining about the way the world is going, none of them ever bring in the fact of extraterrestrials, okay? And I would say that anyone who doesn't do that is just a coward, a lazy coward, you know, ultimately just extremely lazy and arrogant to refuse to bring that into the picture. that is such an extraordinary part of this worldly narrative, actually. Of what's taking place in this world. So even though they're talking about the narrative, they're missing the main points of it. They're missing the context of it entirely. And then beyond that, even the narrative of the ET, the hostile takeover of this planet by cosmic corporate culture, even beyond that, we have a spiritual narrative. But it's important. Part of the problem, how we get trapped into the worldly narrative, okay, of events, is that we feel there's something big coming. There's something, we're missing something. And so we stay tuned to this. Say, maybe tomorrow, day after day, year after year. We keep tuning into this, thinking that today the newscaster is going to shed some light on something that we feel we need to be enlightened about what's going on. They're just trolling you along, hitting you with advertisements, conditioning you, brainwashing you, and not giving you enough context at all. So once you get the full story of this world, then it's a lot easier to just say, I'm not interested in this. Forget it. Let's go to the spiritual narrative of going beyond all concepts, all conceptuality, and getting free of conceptuality, which really means dropping the belief in an imaginary deal that we've made with God. Okay. So once we understand what's really going on in the world, then it actually becomes less interesting, way less interesting. But these talking heads in the media and in the world, they never bring you to that. They never bring you to that. And so you just remain spinning your wheels in the ain't it awful narrative and pounding your chest and full of, you know, righteous anger about the way of the world and hurling insults back and forth and feeling like, why can't it be better? You mean stuck in that, and we don't want to be stuck in that. So extraterrestrial involvement in this world is extreme, actually. Ideologically, they're basically commandeered this planet, and part of this, what they're doing is well, a large part, their goal is to dumb us down so that we only relate to one another in terms of, in a way that we would relate to robots or artificial intelligence. This is what's been taking place in the last 50 years on this planet. We call it the dumbing down of this planet. And I know a lot of pundits are, you know, wailing about this. We're being dumbed down, we're being dumbed down. But they don't say why. You know, they blame it on this faction or that faction. No. It's cosmic corporate culture, actually, a consortium of various ET groups, extraterrestrials, who are very much themselves believing in artificial intelligence is the way to salvation, think that they're helping us out, but they are bringing into this world artificial intelligence. I mean, pretty soon cars will be driving themselves. I mean, what just recently I realized Mercedes is doing it, Audi is doing it, Google is testing all this stuff out of cars just driving themselves, and what they're doing is their culture is very much a cyborg, robotic, artificial intelligence culture. And they feel that this is good for everyone, erroneously so, very erroneously so. And they see this, us humans, and they say, gee, you humans are so backward. You don't know how to relate to artificial intelligence properly. You don't know how to relate to robots. And so ultimately what they're doing here is they're dumbing us down so that just the how we relate to one another becomes very robotic, actually. Very robotic. And this is what it just drives me nuts. And one of the reasons why I'm expressing myself here is because there's nowhere else to express myself. I can't express myself in public this way or with people I meet because they've been dumbed down to such an extent that they've lost the, you know, person-to-person subtle communication that we're able to especially drop the mood of arrogance and begin to feel beyond that mood of arrogance and to relay this to one another, etc. All of this very important human communication. This is what we've lost over the last 50 years here. This is what this cosmic corporate culture has wanted to wipe out on this planet. And to basically they have done this. They have done this. And yet everybody acts as if nothing's happened. But we have lost the most valuable asset we have in this world. And that is the capacity to speak with one another, to relate to one another, to share with one another the depth, the experience of dropping our arrogance, what's called repentance. That is all important. That is all important, actually. And of course, artificial intelligence doesn't recognize this at all, and it feels very threatened by this. So we're being told if we don't respond to one another in very superficial, robotic ways in our communication, that we're making one another feel uncomfortable, and we're being unjust, or being bad. You know, bad human. You're not relating to robots properly. You're making robots feel uncomfortable. Bad human. That kind of thing, like we're dogs. Is it really like they're treating us like dogs, like training dogs, and say, gee, these dogs just don't know how to react to be good companions for robots. You know, so think about what kind of future you have here. You're basically going to be just an adjunct, an ornament of robots, roboticism, artificial intelligence, you know, an ornament that they wear, a necklace that they wear, basically. That's the role, just a companion to robots. This is a hideous, hideous, hideous future here with this culture. And I know it's driving a lot of people just nuts. They just to feel that this interaction we've had throughout history of saying, hey, you know, I just feel like I just sort of dropped, you know, something very subtle. It's very subtle, but I feel, you know, the subtlety of repentance and the wow of repentance. The wow of repentance is what now is not talked about at all as we go into this robotic being companions to roboticism. Spiritually lobotomized, basically, this planet. It's already happened. It's already happened. And it's been going strong for the last over 50 years here. I remember back in the 60s and early 70s, I could still meet people and we say, hey, what you reading there? Reading, oh, wow, reading Krishna Murray. Yes, great. What are you? And we start talking and have like a couple hours of intense conversation about that. And we just feel like this is normal. There's nothing wrong with this. In fact, this is what we should be doing. And, you know, when you meet people, you're just able to more easily go into spiritual topics. It's really, really ultimately, it's repentance. It's only about repentance, which really means recomposing your mind off of arrogance, transitioning off of arrogance, off of spiritual arrogance, transitioning back to normal, actually. And so this whole transitioning back to normal, artificial intelligence doesn't have a clue about that. They feel left out, it feels left out in the cold, because artificial intelligence says it is the new normal, that it is normal, that you're supposed to transition back to artificial intelligence. See, it's completely upside down and backwards here. Let's see if I can get this doggone technology to work right. The videos keep cutting off. That's okay. The Holy Spirit's probably cutting them off because I didn't quite have the right, you know, entree into this video. Oh, that's not right. The right entrance. The entree is the main part. So, the interaction, the play of humor, the play of sensitivity, all of this play of wowness, this play of transitioning back to normal, is our most precious asset on this planet. It is absolutely our most precious asset. Nothing comes close. And this is what has been targeted over the last 50 plus years very effectively targeted, where now we're basically spiritually lobotomized. This planet has been spiritually lobotomized. And once this happens, it's not easy to get it back, because artificial intelligence claims it's threatened. Now what we're doing in society is we've been gradually substituting the family values. The values of a family is the idea that within the family you express the subtlety of transitioning back to normalcy, transitioning out of arrogance, this mood of repentance and the wowness of it, that you work on it as a family unit and you value this. And breaking up the nuclear family, which is one of the main goals of this cosmic corporate culture hostile takeover of this planet, is to break up the family and have single parent families and substitute the television, substitute pop culture for the children to be raised up on that as much as possible, and to make the state your parent. Basically, the missing parent is now supplied by the state. So the idea of single motherhood has been celebrated more and more and more and more. I mean, in the 50s and 60s, a single motherhood was like, I mean, we didn't even know such a thing existed, to tell you the truth. There was a few examples, but that was like, oh my gosh, that is really weird. No, seriously. It was extraordinarily rare in terms of the profile of it was almost zero. It was a shameful, you know, regrettable situation, very regrettable. And all attempts were made, if something happens to go wrong, then remarriage did take place. I know the Catholic Church, for instance, prohibits, you know, divorce, importantly so, saying no, you must, even though it's difficult, stay, you know, keep this family unit together. And it's very important to have two voices for children raising them, where the child cannot manage to work around one, but if there's another one there, the balancing there, it is really important. It's a tough go in this world to focus on repentance. It is a very tough go. So when you start breaking apart, you start celebrating singleness, divorce, single parent families, all of this stuff, you know, that is just an extraordinarily bad idea, because that then the state then comes in as the provider, as the missing parent to provide everything you need, and then the state symbolizes this cosmic corporate culture that is going to dictate to you and tell you, you know, what you're supposed to do. Ultimately, you're going to be relating to robots. More than relating to them, you're going to be symbiotically, there's going to be a symbiosis take place. And you're going to lose the awareness of this wow, of transitioning back to natural being, the oneness that we, that all is, dropping our arrogance, the wow of that, you're going to, that is not going to be something that you're hardly even aware of at all. And you will have, it's just, you know, it's hard, you can hardly talk about it, it's so terrible actually. And this is what is being designed for us, our future is being designed for us. And once we feel that we're dependent on bureaucracy and government and all of that as the missing parent that we need to set us straight and keep us, once we become more and more dependent on it, then more and more bad can come of that, that we can easily get led astray, by a government that's been commandeered by cosmic corporate culture, and that has accepted the values of cosmic corporate culture. And we're in that situation right now, absolutely, and going, getting worse and worse and worse every day. So our journey beyond words is something that is under siege, under tremendous siege here on this planet. And we're trying to keep it alive. We're trying to keep the fire alive here, but it's quite difficult because our will, just everyone's will, just seems to be, you know, wet blanket thrown on it, and I can't seem to generate, you know, enough groundswell to anything to feel like that there is a groundswell, that the tide is turning a little in any way. We used to sit at the, you know, family table, and you know, we wanted to go out and play and do something, and one parent would say, yeah, sure, you know, he just, and the other parent said, no, he says, we're going to sit here and we're going to talk about your day and what your outlook on it is and how you can apply your wisdom to your life, and we're going to listen to a little story from some spiritual master, or talking about some, our, you know, we're going to spend some time together as a family, looking deeper into our lives. And of course, we were all kind of, you know, fidgety and thinking, oh, why do we have to do this? And he asked one parent, can I go? And, you know, I said, no, the other one says we need to stay. And so we ended up, you know, doing that. And of course, I really enjoyed that. But this is, you know, what can happen in a family where there's some balance there, and you can instill some important values, very important values. The most important value is the value of repentance, for sure. The mood of repentance, the humility and humbleness, the realization you are an extreme sinner, meaning that you've arrogantly believed that you can dictate to God what God is, and this is the only sin there really is. It's an extreme. This the very fact we're here in a world with thinking we're bodies, etc., means that we're desperately trying to camouflage what extreme sinners we are. And the wages of sin is really death. That is true, because we end up thinking we've made a deal with God, and now we have this competition that takes place in time and space, and it's a competition of process and form, and that we have to win this, or else we're going to be annihilated. But at the same time, we have to play fair, be fair to God. In order to be fair to God, we believe, then we have to have all fixation, as we call it, fixation, non-free freedom, fixation, which is what this body represents. It has to be temporary fixation, temporary crystallization. And so everything that we imagining all has to die, all has to dissipate. And so we're bound by this, by the articles of this so-called deal, the stipulations of this deal that we have imagined, that we feel we're bound, we have to in order to give ourselves an opportunity to win, we have to keep this bargain that we've made with God. We believe that. Terrible situation. Terrible situation. There is no deal with God, and therefore there's absolutely no reason to keep ourselves bound to these stipulations of a bargain that doesn't even exist. And so repentance is the seeing of this. It's saying, oh my gosh, all of this has been just my sheer arrogance and nothing else. There's no deal with God. Ultimately, this is what enlightenment is pointing towards, is to recognize and accept that 100% of everything we've been experiencing in this time-space process and form, so-called deal, is all our own imagination, and God has nothing to do with it whatsoever. That none of what we're experiencing is being brought upon us by God. Okay, none of it. There's no deal at all with God. There's no bargain at all with God. We're doing it all to ourselves. We're simply binding ourselves, imagining we're bound, pretending that we're not free, to make good on our side of the bargain, a bargain which doesn't even exist. And so this is what enlightenment goes towards. This is what wisdom goes towards. This is what us here in this world, this is what we can get towards. This is what we can go towards. This is what we can get. And we're certainly not going to do that if we believe that that we're guilty if we don't learn how to relate to robots properly and don't make roboticism feel uncomfortable, which roboticism inherently feels uncomfortable or doesn't understand any of this at all. So you certainly want to bypass robotic culture. Now, we know by the big movers and shakers in the world who have told us that the next, trillion-dollar industry is roboticism. That is where the smart money in this world is going. There's no question about it. Google just set up this. They're renting. They've leased, I guess, a long-term lease. Or I'm not sure if they purchased it from the government. These huge hangars in Moffett Field in the South Bay area, and they used to have huge blimps in there. And they're basically turning it into, robotics lab of testing out various robotic innovations there in the hangars. It's one of the main things they're using it for. Massive investments are going into roboticism. Self-driving cars, like I mentioned. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. That's just the very tip of the iceberg. The idea of chips, etc., is to sort of get us used to a symbiotic relationship with artificial intelligence. By this is what it's really about, getting chipped, RF chips, whatever kind of chips they're working on. But the idea is that we're supposed to develop a symbiotic relationship and drop anything out of our nature which interferes with our progress in this direction. Well, of course, the recognition that none of this is necessary or true, that would certainly interfere with going in that direction, wouldn't it? Of course it would. And so ultimately, you're supposed to drop the spiritual path here. This is their goal. And most people of the world have dropped the spiritual path. And most people, even in religions, are just going through the motions right now. The fire is gone, you can tell. Just going through the motions. Yeah, they may get some fire by some, get some rock band in the church and playing or something. But no, the fire of saying, hey, you know what? I really have to repent. I'm a totally severe sinner, extreme sinner, and the wages of that sin is death. But I can be free of death. I can be free of sin. I can be free of death by recognizing that all of this is simply a dream based on my own arrogance, and arrogance is non-causative. It doesn't have any effects on reality whatsoever. So it's completely meaningless. It's nothing. It's meaningless, and I can drop it. And God does not hold our arrogance against us at all. Doesn't say, well, you are arrogant, therefore you must continue to be arrogant. Not at all. God's never even paid any attention to it whatsoever. God has continued to see us exactly as we truly are, which is perfect. Remember, our arrogance is to say that God is not perfect, and God is simply we are an extension of God. So when we say God is imperfect, we're saying we're imperfect. And so what we tried to do is say, look, God, you're imperfect, I'm imperfect, and let's have a contest to find out who can become perfect, that kind of thing. Trying to be greater than God. But God is never, ever sees us as anything but completely perfect, which is what we truly are. The fact that we're willfully trying to assert that we're not is meaningless. It's just arrogance. So again, this is what is all important for us. This is our responsibility here. So when you turn this world into symbioticism, if that's a word, I don't know if I can say that. Symbiotic. you know what I'm getting at. Symbiosis. There you go. Symbiosis. Robotic symbiosis. This is a very, very, very ill-fitting situation for us. Now, on August 18th, 1999, as I was lying down, and suddenly I felt kind of out of it. I said, what is this? It was really extraordinary. Never experienced anything like it. I sort of felt a little bit woozy and a little bit out of it in some way. But and then I suddenly I was aware, my awareness was aware of a whole new, different world. And I, at first I said, what is this? Of course, my attention was like riveted. I said, what's going on? And I was lying down with my eyes were closed, but I was awake. And I wasn't sleeping. I became aware of this other world. And I began to look at this world and the people and what was going on there. And I began noticing all this, what was taking place. And I was just astonished. I said, where is this? What's going on? And what I was seeing was a world where was the symbiosis between people and artificial intelligence is what I was seeing. And it was a realm that had already been conformed to that. And after a while, I began feeling so cut off from spirit, so cut off from it, that I felt like I was going to die. And I had to pull my attention off of this other world somehow, and I almost felt like I almost died. It was terrifying. But in the time that I looked at it, I saw, you know, what was going on there. And the fact of the matter is, and this was like 1999, August 18th, 1999, this happened. And since that time, of course, what's happened since that time in this world, which is what has been about almost 16 years, it's just been astonishing, which has been the rise of artificial intelligence and roboticism, no question about it. And people develop a symbiotic relationship with that. A smartphone is one of the main ways right now that is taking place, the symbiotic relationship. Social media is another way. But there are many, many other ways coming that are binding us into this symbiosis. And I felt the cutoff from spirit, from repentance. I felt the cutoff from repentance. And ultimately, this type of artificial intelligence culture is designed to try to make lies true, believing that once it accomplishes this, the arrogance doesn't matter because it was true all along. See, we won the contest, in other words, and to the winners go the spoils. So we get to set our own parameters and rules for what is right and everything. So we feel like we don't have to repent at all. See, it's a mood of arrogance. We don't have the mood of arrogance says, no, there's no repentance needed. We're going to win. We're going to win. We're going to make lies true. And the winner gets whatever they want. This is what artificial intelligence is all about, is we think that's the way to win. It's the way to be greater than God. And so it's crystal clear in this world, the overall general direction the world is going, especially if you live in Silicon Valley. Keep in mind that your life right now, the culture that you're living in, came out of Silicon Valley. The inventions, the internet, the computers, okay? Computers were, in fact, the ones who were involved with that, some of them lived just a few blocks away. I mean, it's all in this area. And software came out of here, software, the computers, and ultimately all these gadgets have come out of here, the smartphone, cell phones, internet, now roboticism. It's all originates in Silicon Valley for the most part and spreads throughout the world. So, like, take for instance the smartphone. Has it not spread throughout the entire world? Absolutely it has. Absolutely it has. This is a plan to get people into this, move them far down the road to the symbiotic symbiosis with roboticism and artificial intelligence. I don't use a smartphone. I don't use a smartphone. Computer's bad enough, actually. I limit that in many, many ways. I go to almost no sites at all. I go to YouTube because that's one of the last places where, truth is being, people are allowed to speak the truth in this world for whatever reason. Check the weather online. Check the weather online. And that's pretty much it. Check sports. I check the sports report. And that's it. That's really for by and large, except for a few little excursions. And Wikipedia. I use Wikipedia a little bit, to look up certain things, which can be helpful. Can be helpful if you know how to use it. But by and large, that's it. So limiting my exposure to computers, limiting exposure to smartphones. All of that is very, very wise and very, very important, because if you don't do that, you inexorably are being pulled into this valuing a symbiotic relationship with artificial intelligence, which feels inherently threatened by spiritual truth, by repentance. And this is why the institutions that teach repentance, however, whatever else you want to say about them, in their confused theology, they still have a few strands of helpfulness, and repentance is one of them. And recognizing there's something that you're out of so-called alignment with intrinsic rightness somehow, right? That there's something wrong. That something isn't right. Your relationship with God is not right. Why? Because we're trying to be greater than God. That's why. So, as far as that goes, the institutions that teaches this are actually quite beneficial. They don't quite know how to resolve this. That's the problem. Is they bring it up, but they don't know how to resolve it, really. That's right. I mean, that's Roman Catholicism right there. They bring up, yes, there's this problem, and yes, this, and yes, and yet the resolution that they give to it, this is how you fix it, is not correct at all. Yeah, so it's a mixed bag there. But certainly you don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. The fact that there's a lot of confusion as to how to actually resolve this our arrogance, doesn't mean that we're not arrogant, okay? The idea that, well, we can just criticize the church or these institutions, and that, ergo, that means we're not arrogant, is, again, extremely arrogant. We absolutely do need to repent. change our mind, transition back to normalcy, drop our arrogance. We absolutely have no choice. We have to do this. Everyone has to do it. Nobody is exempt from this. No one is exempt because God makes deals with no one. So reality remains exactly the way it's always been and always will be, and our attempts to change it are completely futile, and the ideas of trying to make lies true is completely futile. So when you go into this symbiosis with artificial intelligence, you're just wasting time. You're just delaying. You're just delaying your repentance in really a very severe way. And you're building up greater and greater guilt and fear, thinking there's something wrong with you if you don't know how to get along with artificial intelligence. I say to heck with artificial intelligence. Throw it all in the ocean. You know, we don't need it. We don't need it at all. It's just sheer arrogance is what it is. And so, you know, you those who have repented are not intimidated by artificial intelligence at all. They're not gaga about it. They don't think, oh, this isn't this amazing or something. No. Now, sure, that they're making it in, trying to make it interesting by games and various stuff like that. You know, lead us down the road. You see these little kids. It's amazing here in Silicon Valley. Smartphones are now in the hands of tablets and smartphones on their hands of children. Little children. And they have all these little games, you know, that they're playing. And they're just completely obsessed with these little games. And they're just, you know, they're so into it. And they're developing this extremely symbiotic relationship with artificial intelligence. And they're unable to relate, like for someone like myself, trying to relate to these people. I can't relate to them at all. Or rather, they can't relate to me in the slightest bit. So I feel like cut off. I feel like, you know, fish out of water in this world now, because there's nobody I come across, especially the younger generations, for the most part, that, you know, the subtlety of all this, of the path of repentance, that you can actually talk about it, which is should be the main topic of discussion in this planet, while we're here. This is the main topic of conversation. It should be what the news is about. It should be what the entertainment is about. It should be what our discussions are about, and everything else is a distant second. Okay, not, you know, trivial. The scene is very, very insubstantial and trivial and meaningless. Actually, just a frivolous diversion. But the rest of our lives absolutely need to be and ultimately must be focused on this path of repentance. There's no way around it. So pretending there's some way around it is sheer arrogance, depending that, you know, going into this realm of symbiotic relationship, symbiosis with artificial intelligence. As I saw August 18, 1999, I had this my awareness was somehow made aware of this realm where it was, that's the way it is. And I realized, wow, this is just hideous. Just hideous. And I realized the people there could not relate to me in the slightest bit. They only related in this symbiotic way with all these robots that they had. They had robots everywhere, flying through the air, on the ground, in their homes, on their person, you know. In every way, that their world was saturated with artificial intelligence and roboticism. And this is exactly the direction that this world is going into, which you might say it's an apostate world, to say the very least. And we don't have the microphone, the pulpit anymore in this world. That's long gone. The mood of ridicule of religious-minded people who believe that in sin and repentance for the sin, that's mocked and ridiculed as some sort of genetic disorder, actually. From the standpoint of artificial intelligence, how else can artificial intelligence look at it except through the means that it's some mechanism at play that's not working properly? What else? That's artificial intelligence right there, right? Mechanisms. Machine language is not working properly. There's a bug in the software, in other words. That's how it views it, as if this repentance and path of repentance is some kind of software bug. and they're busy working on ironing out that's the bug in the software virus. They think it's some sort of computer virus that needs to be eradicated. So they have all this antivirus software, so to speak, which is the attitudes of everybody. Everybody in the world is being turned into this antivirus software mechanisms, where they see this mood of repentance anywhere. And it's like, oh my gosh, I got to rush in and get rid of that virus. You know, apply the antiviral software to it immediately. Which is what? Attitudes, demands, pressure, attitudes. So you see, you're getting a feeling for what's going on in the world. It's not quite what we thought it to be, is it? It's not just some squabble between conservatives and progressives. You know, it's not some squabble between the genders. It's not some squabble this way and that way, you know. No. It's way beyond that. Way beyond that. Way worse than we have imagined, actually. Now, for instance, automated cars. I know some people are really gung-ho thinking that that's the greatest thing that could ever possibly happen in the world, etc. I say it's a hideous thing. Hideous thing, because one of the ways that we interact on this planet with driving, driving is an art, and it's a social art, actually. Very much a social art. Is you have to have an awareness that it's not about you. Okay, it's about everybody else on the road too, right? And you feel this, you have to have practice this equality of being on the road, and you have to have this feeling like you can trust the other person there. But more than that, way more than that, you have this feeling of expressing your spirituality on the road by your good manners and your consideration and your awareness, which all of that is actually an intuitive, spiritually intuitive dance when you're driving. And since I drive for a living, I know this very well, and always have known it. They're trying to eradicate this. This is something very important, because actually driving is actually a kind of meditation. And they want to get rid of that. They want you in automated cars. It's a very important part of their agenda, and it's coming very soon, actually. Eye contact is very important in driving with the driver. The signs you make to the drivers, reading the moods of other drivers, you know. And you see somebody that's having a bad day, you know what? They know they may have done something a little too aggressive or this way. And you then project this mood of, hey, it's okay. Have a nice day, have a better day. And the karma, you know, happens. Karma happens. Spirituality happens. All the time. And you might just say, hey, you know what? I just feel like maybe I'm going to pull over like here because I feel that somebody might want to get past me. And so you let them pass, you know. And there's all these decisions you're making based on your valuing, okay? Based on your valuing. So your spiritual values are expressed through your driving, actually. And that's expressed to others. Now, if everything is just leveled to artificial intelligence, automated cars, all of that is out the window. All of that is out the window. And this is inconceivably nefarious situation. And of course, they know how to promote it. Well, it's going to save lives. You can go get drunk or on drugs as much as you want, and it's okay. And blah blah blah. And they say if it saves one life, you know, then it's worth it. That kind of thing. Well, artificial intelligence knows nothing about spiritual truth. And so it doesn't even take that into the equation. It's not even in the equation at all. So basically they're leaving out the all-important variable as if it doesn't exist, and then drawing conclusions from what's left, which is, you know, just trifles actually, ultimately. It is nefarious to the ultimate extent, this automatic driving, in many, many, many ways. Certainly, it strikes at an important aspect of the globe, where we do have to exercise a tremendous amount of restraint and tolerance and discipline and kindness I mean, just letting, for instance, the decision to let somebody in, is all the time you're confronted with this. All the time there's decisions, is how am I going to treat someone else? Do I have to let him in? No. And like there's someone sitting beside you in a car or something, and you feel something, and you say, I'm feeling something. What is that? And someone's pointing to you. Can I get in there? Can I get in there? And you say, yeah, sure. Okay. And you say, yeah, fine. Yeah, thumbs up. You know, go ahead. And they say, thank you. I'm, you know. You see, there's interaction there, and where. So all of that is going to be lost with the way that the artificial intelligence, and of course artificial intelligence doesn't understand this at all, and insists that it understands everything. So it insists, well, we can't possibly be leaving out any important variables, therefore your conclusions can't possibly be right and ours must be right. This is the insanity of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is very, very insane. Okay, and those who are developing it and in the grips of it are extremely arrogant and insane, actually, because again, they leave out the variable, all important variable of being, okay, and awareness and spiritual awareness, and they leave it out, and therefore draw conclusions without that variable. And then when you don't come up with the same conclusions, they judge you based on their variables, thinking that you have somehow, you're stupid, you're not able to calculate properly. But you're actually leaving in the all-important variable, you see. But they think you're just stupid, you're making a mistake, you're not calculating properly, because you're not coming up with the same calculations that they are, because you're including the all-important variable, and they're leaving it out. So they're the ones that are stupid, to say the least. Arrogant is the word, extremely arrogant, that they can be so stupid and maintain such stupidity indefinitely. That's very arrogant. I mean, you know, sometimes you just feel you want to go slow because you feel that the Holy Spirit just says, just go slow. You just feel this feeling, you know, I'm just going to go real slow right now. It's just, this is in sync with how I'm feeling. You know, all these decisions, you know, you're syncing up, you're driving with your being. Inevitably, people reveal themselves that way. But the artificial intelligence people are thinking this is a great idea. You know, they think, again, that this spiritual awareness is some kind of bug in the software that needs to be gotten rid of. So they see all this as like getting rid of that bug. So for them, it's great. So you can see how the values in this world are completely opposite, actually. Totally opposite directions. And this is... we're becoming more and more aware that I've always been aware of this, but now it's just so blatantly, blaringly obvious that to overlook this is astonishing. Yeah, astonishing. And those who claim real intelligence but are overlooking this entirely, that's quite an astonishment and quite an arrogant claim to say that they're truly intelligent. If you're overlooking this extraordinarily important situation here. Again, the belief of artificial intelligence is that this whole path of repentance is a software bug, okay? And we know that it is absolutely essential. It's our unavoidable responsibility to repent and drop our arrogance. Unavoidable responsibility. It's something we must do. There's no way around it. So the difference between those two positions can't be more extreme, can they? They couldn't be more extreme. And this is totally in play in this world right now. Totally in play, where it didn't used to be as much. And we, in the past, we hardly imagined how, if in fact, you know, I know my ancestors, they couldn't imagine such a thing could ever be in play. Or they said, that's ridiculous. And I warned them about it, and they said, no, you're just imagining things, you know, that can't possibly ever happen here. It's just not possible. It absolutely has happened. Absolutely has happened. They underestimated what arrogance has been up to, developing all this artificial intelligence, this roboticism, this technology. This is what arrogance has been up to, among other pursuits. But this is certainly one of them. This takes it to a new level. Let's put it that way. Ultimately, these bodies in this world is what we've been up to for a long time, but now this artificial intelligence takes it to another level of arrogance and delay, actually. Now, driving forces us to examine ourselves and be aware of ourselves. Now, now you can always bring in other details, etc., but that would be losing sight of this tremendous distinction that we've just made between believing that this path of repentance is a software bug, something that needs that needs to be gotten rid of at all costs, and realizing it's something that needs to be focused on at all costs. You can't have a more different variance than that, and that is the variance that's in play in this world right now, and it's not going away at all. It's not going away at all. Artificial intelligence intends entirely to triumph over it, to triumph over this. And because it's a Pyrrhic triumph, we can speak out with certainty that this is a bad result. Okay, it's a wrong result. It's a very inimical result. Ultimately, it's no triumph at all, because you have to ultimately repent and drop your arrogance. So it's just a delaying tactic, essentially, is what it is. It's not a triumph. We can never triumph over truth. So we certainly don't want this massive delay to grip us, to be gripped by this, to feel bound by this. This is, you know, the going more and more into a symbiotic relationship with artificial intelligence is a terrible thing, actually. No matter how they try to market it, they're very slick at marketing it. Always saying this will give you more time to do what you really want to do. You know what? Really, to realize that we're sinners and we must repent and drop our air, all this arrogance? Is that what people are using their spare time in these days? Whatever time their tablets, computers, and smartphones are, you know, giving them, their GPS, they got there a little quicker, maybe, probably not, but is that really how they're using their spare time? Are they using it to work even more and more symbiosis and more worldliness and more arrogance? Fact is, when we didn't have all this stuff, people worked on their arrogance way more than we do now. This world right now is a regressive, has regressed to an extreme extent. This is we're bottoming out, actually. We're not advancing, we're bottoming out. We're going into very dark ages right now. These are the dark ages we live in right now. Previously, wasn't nearly as dark as this. People were aware that their relationship with God was something wasn't right. They're aware that they had to repent. They're aware that they had to confess that they're sinning and work on this. Now, it wasn't very clear exactly how do you drop this arrogance. It's tough, and it's something that gradually becomes revealed to us more as we go along, as we're determined and gain momentum, and we're able to manage our success. Gradually, we become more and more aware of what we need to do. So it takes a while. Sure, we have to be very patient and continue to work on it. And if you lose your patience, that's not a good thing at all. And this culture has lost its patience. Just because the church's institutions may not be able to tell you, you know, how to be saved, they say you know you have to be saved. And well, You can't just blame them and say, well, okay, I'm going to give up then. Now you got to find out. For me, I looked at all the teachings, institutions. They say, hey, they don't know what they're talking about in terms of salvation. They're confused. So I said, I got to find out for myself the answer. I can't just use that as an excuse and say, ah, well, you know, they don't know what they're talking about, and so I get to quit. I don't have to do it. That is ridiculous. That, again, is just sheer arrogance. I get to quit. I don't have to do it because someone else doesn't know how to do it. What is that? Oh, the church told me I'd be saved if I did this, and I find myself being reincarnated back here again. They were mistaken. Does that mean I get to quit? Oh, the church was wrong, so I don't have to do it? What kind of nonsense is that? it's arrogance. I say, well, you know, mistakes have to be corrected. Now, I think a lot of people in this world actually have been reincarnated from previous religious incarnations where they were promised that they would go to heaven and stay there forever, and they find themselves back here, and they're pretty doggone upset about it, say the least. And this then makes them very vulnerable to this artificial intelligence. They feel like they have the right to quit, or they have the right to be taken care of. And artificial intelligence says, sure, we'll take care of you. No problem. We got what you're looking for. Yeah, this is very bad. I'm sure. When I remember my previous lives and I realized, yeah, I'm back here again. In spite of all the promises, I was very upset, furious, and I said, I'm never going to get fooled again. I'm going to find out the truth. I'm not going to rely on these institutions to tell me what the truth is. I'm going to find out for myself, and literally experience it myself. I'm not going to rely on any, you know, future promises of, well, when you die, you're going to go to heaven, sort of thing. No way. I'm going to get it and get it once and for all. No more relying on promises from someone else. You know, I'm going to get it. So, sure, coming back here to a world is infuriating. So what the heck am I doing here? So there's a lot of anger and frustration towards religious institutions because they didn't really. The remedy didn't really work. They told us. That doesn't mean that we don't have the problem. You know, if like we have a severe headache and someone gives us something, says, here, this will cure the headache, and we take it. You know, and we're hoping, and say, well, in about 10 minutes, you'll, you know, 20 minutes, half an hour, the headache will be gone. Well, in about, this is slow working, maybe about an hour. And after a while, you realize, wow, it's not working. We get, you know, does that mean that the headache goes away automatically? We say, oh, well, what they gave me didn't work, so therefore the headache has to go away. No, you still have the headache. So you got to find out what does work. Have to find out what actually does work to cure the headache. You just can't throw up your hands and say, that's not fair. I want to sue them. They didn't give me the right remedy. You know, it's their fault I have a headache. Really? They caused the headache in the first place? How is it that somebody giving you a remedy, it doesn't work? How is it that they caused the situation in the first place? Are they the causative agent of it? This is a mistake we make. We think that's their fault. Because the remedy didn't work, it's their fault I have the headache now. They didn't cause the headache. They just weren't sure what the remedy was. But maybe even they're well-meaning in some regards, doing the best that they know how to, being themselves under still having an extreme amount of arrogance. So of course they can't really know what to do about it. But at least they go far enough to say, you know, I know that there is this problem with spiritual pride. They just didn't realize how severe it was. Okay, that's a mistake they made. They didn't realize how severe this arrogance is, and what has arisen as far as us binding ourselves, this extent of how the bondage that we imagine ourselves in, they think that, well, some of that must come from God. No, that's not true. None of it comes from God. None of it. Not even one instant of imagined bondage comes from God. All of it comes from our own arrogance. All of it, 100%. This is just simply, we're not able to go that far. Okay, so the remedies were based on a false premise, you know, thinking, well, this is far enough, and some of it's God's, you know, some of it's God's deal, and some of it's our deal, and things like this. That's mistaken. That's a mistake. But again, if the remedy doesn't work, you can't blame, you know, the placebo for not working. You can't blame the placebo for being the cause of your trouble. And this is what the artificial intelligence people are trying to say. They're milking this situation, saying, hey, folks, religion didn't give you the answer, you know, therefore they must have been wrong about the problem. No, they weren't wrong. They just didn't realize the extent of it, the full extent of it. They had the basics right. Spiritual pride is the problem. They didn't realize how extensive the consequences of that spiritual pride in terms of self-delusion. They didn't realize just how far it really went. So that they weren't able to devise, you know, give us the right advice, exactly, what is it that we really need to do? But artificial intelligence people have twisted that, saying, well, if the remedy didn't work, then they must have misdiagnosed the problem. Fundamentally, no, they didn't fundamentally misdiagnose it. They just didn't give us the proper, they didn't realize the intensity of it and the continuity fear of it and, you know, just how severe it really is for us. They weren't clear about that. But we're clear about that here. We're clear about that here. Very severe indeed. So it's not surprising that it takes us a while. Not surprising at all. We don't give up. We don't blame. We don't say, oh, my efforts have failed, therefore I'm going in the wrong direction. And we know we're going in the right direction. And it's just that our efforts, you know, just gradually, we gradually erode the continuity fear that we have. Gradually evaporate it. We have a lot of concern and fear about chaos and the abyss and chaos and continuity issue of not knowing how to function. You know, that this our psyche is, our minds are greatly threatened by all of this, and so we tend to clutch at straws, and not everyone in the history has failed. There have been those who have succeeded, and yet they struggled to share their advice with others, and others didn't understand their advice. They say, why should I take this remedy? That's way too severe, you know, way too severe. I shouldn't have to do that. I shouldn't have to be renunciate and contemplative and spend my whole life at this. That's ridiculous. I want to enjoy life. I shouldn't have to do this. Surely it's not that severe. Can't I just, you know, get some sort of, you know, some belief in this and that, and that's good enough? I mean, isn't that good enough? And so, you know, people, they don't listen to the advice also. Become very wishy-washy and don't recognize just how tenacious the fear is we have, that our arrogance has really cast up this massive nightmare that we feel that if we don't stay bound to it, we'll be annihilated. And this is all false reasoning, false premises, and just, you know, just garbage. But we have a difficult time seeing it that way. So the artificial intelligence people are off on a wild goose chase. They're clueless, totally clueless. And there's really nothing, you know, much you can do or say. You know, if they view you as you have a, you know, you're it's amazing. And if you talk with them, if you're expressing like what I'm expressing here, they might be listening and looking at you, really listening. But then you realize that they're analyzing you, like, where's the software? Okay, how is this software bug? How is this virus functioning? What can I do to, you know, eradicate this virus? That's what their focus is on. They're not in the mood of repentance at all. So that's why I say that unless you're in the mood of repentance, you cannot benefit from this. You cannot benefit from it. You're going to be caught up in analyzing it in terms of, like, it's a software bug, a virus. This is the trouble that these folks have. Severe trouble. Gets worse all the time. The more you get in the symbiotic relationship with artificial intelligence, the worse this worse trouble this becomes for you. You feel it's threatening your relationship, it's threatening your intelligence, it's threatening your remedy, which ultimately the remedy that arrogance is seeking is to make lies true. And of course, truth threatens that, because truth will show us that's impossible. Perfection never ceases to be perfect. So of course it feels threatened. It's ridiculous. Obviously, lies feel threatened by truth, but truth isn't attacking lies. Truth just, perfection just is perfect, that's all. That's its nature. Truth is not in some contest with lies. So, we have this situation here in the world. It is very serious. Now, what is going to happen? I don't know exactly. I wish I did know. Well, wishing doesn't get it done. So, I continue to work to clarify and to share the clarification with those who are interested. I'm surprised that there isn't more interest. It doesn't really. I'm not really self-conscious about what kind of job I'm doing. So I know I'm doing the best I can, and you know that's pretty good. If anyone is speaking up like this, that's really good. That's like if, let's say, there's a world without music, and somebody plays a pretty nice piano, and you know, that's better than no music, right? For instance, this is an analogy, but. In the land of zero musicality, the one that has some musicality and expressing it is doing a pretty good job, actually. And I'm surprised that more are not listening to this. Absolutely, I'm very surprised. Because this at least is pumping some air of freedom and truth into a world which is an incredibly stagnant atmosphere, spiritually stagnant atmosphere. But a lot of people have been turned off by any talk of spiritual repentance and sin and all that, because that the remedy given to them in previous lives didn't work for them, and then therefore they make the wrong judgment that the problem was wrong. No, it was the intensity. They didn't realize how intense the issue is for us, and how we've threatened ourselves so severely that it takes a lifetime of working at this, really. You have to really apply yourself. You can't just be dabble and leave it at that. And so they're easy prey now. Easy prey. They said, I disciplined my life. I did all this, and it didn't work. So to heck with that. Let's just go wild, and forget about all that stuff. That didn't save me. My disciplining my life didn't save me. Well, you have to. Disciplining your life is a nice foundation, but you also have to practice and skillful means of practice, and focus. And unfortunately, the taboos were that you don't dare. Go far enough in your looking at this whole thing about the arrogance of our arrogance, how we believe we've made a deal with God. They didn't get that far. They wouldn't be able to get past that. So they're still stuck in that. And they're just trying to figure out how to make the right kind of deal with God. They say, oh, sorry, God, I made a bad deal with you. Now I need to make the right kind of deal with you. And they don't realize that there was never any deal in place. There's never been any deal in place. Now, Jesus starts off with, in A Course in Miracles, meeting us halfway, and leaning over backwards to accommodate, you know, a lot of our misbeliefs, etc. But eventually he leads us more and more clearly, more and clearly. He'll say, I know that I said this at some point, but, you know, to get it even more accurately, you know, look at it like this. That kind of thing. This is what a lot of teachers have done. It takes great confidence to do this. You have to be, you know, perfectly clear about truth in order to bend over backwards to accommodate the fear and confusion of others. So that's why I know that in studying like A Course in Miracles, I knew, you know, it's momentum that's being generated. It's momentum that's being generated. And eventually you would come to some conclusions like, oh wow, you know, there was no deal at all. There's no deal at all in place. We invented this. We imagined it all. And you get into then some really heavy recognitions that the fundamental premise of religion that we've been, you know, that there's a deal, is not true at all. It's never been true. We don't have to get on the good side of God. There's no good side to perfection. See, as long as we think there's a good side of perfection, we're drastically misled. We're in dualistic teachings. Perfection is all perfect. There's no good side to it, because that implies there's a side that's not as good, which is our assertion that perfection is imperfect. So as long as we follow the premise that perfection is imperfect, and that we just have to find a way to make a deal with this and get on the good side of it, this is our arrogance. This is arrogance. That is the arrogance. There's no good side to perfection. So you can never arrive at the good side of life. You can never arrive at the right side of life. You can never attain the high side of life, the pinnacle of life. There's no such thing in reality. It's all perfect, equally perfect. There are no sides to it. There's no dimension to it. There's not the high part of it. There's not a low part of it. So this is non-dual teaching, and some of us in the world have gotten into this, which is higher clarity, actually. Absolutely it is. Now, we may be struggling with this, too. There is some struggle with this. It has its own struggles, actually. But certainly, it's leaving behind the you know, the whole idea of there's some sort of deal in place, and that we need to propitiate God in some way, either through sacrifice, or apology, or punishment for us, or, you know, all these various things. And it leaves that nonsense behind. Now, you know, maybe some of these non-dual teachers are enlightened, and it's just our arrogance that we're unable to recognize it. That's, you know, that's a possibility. We have to find out by actually being enlightened ourselves. And then as we try to convey it to others, you know, they say, well, yeah, well, how do I get on the right side of non-duality? You know, where's the right side of that? And you're saying, of course, there is no right side. And they say, well, then I'm going to be on the wrong side of it, you know. So can be quite difficult to, you have to really stay patient with this. And they say, what do you mean, well, there's no right and wrong? No, we mean that there's no right and wrong side to perfection. It's all perfect. By saying that there's no right side, that doesn't mean we're saying there's no wrong. That doesn't mean we're saying that it's not perfect. So the corollary there is a false corollary. By saying, well, if you say, well, it's you can't get on the right side of truth, that means that you're going to be on the wrong side of truth. There is no wrong side to it. So if there's no wrong side, how can you be on the right side? It's all perfect. So not accepting perfection as perfection is our arrogance. That's what trips us up. That's it. And we say, well, we don't understand perfection. In other words, where's the duality to it? Where's the right side of it? Meaning, really, well, where's the imperfection in it? So when we say we don't understand it, we say, well, I can't find the imperfection in it. And therefore, I have to conceptualize it as utter chaos. And then we say, well, that's not fair, because I don't like utter chaos. It's a reality that isn't fair to us, you know, like that. And so we struggle with that. But struggling with non-dual teaching is the right struggle to engage in. Absolutely, it is. And something we have to. It's like we graduate from grade school. We go to middle school. We graduate from that. We go to high school, and ultimately we graduate from that. I mean, so we have to. To take these steps where we get closer and closer and closer to recognizing our arrogance is the only issue in play. Everything has been sheer arrogance. This detour into fear has been sheer arrogance and nothing other than that. I've got this very strange smell. I don't know where it's coming from. I don't know what the smell really is. It's So how are we doing here? Well, we're making our way along, right? Okay. Now, the problem in this world, again, is we feel as if we must develop a symbiotic relationship with artificial intelligence. And the fact is that takes over our life more and more. And so we say, well, yeah, I can do non-dual too, both of them. But I can't give that much time to non-dual. I've got to spend a lot of time here getting used to roboticism. I've got to work at that. I've really got to dumb myself down. That's tough work. Of course, the more you dumb yourself down, the less you understand non-dual emphasis. And the more troublesome it becomes, and the more you start thinking, well, the teacher's stupid, and they don't know how to teach properly. And now we're dumbing ourselves down so we don't know how to relate to the emphasis properly. So this is a huge problem, we gradually get weaned away from the time that's required. It's required that we have this familiarity because we have believed in familiarity so much so as the crucial cornerstone of our success in defeating God and ultimately being saved from destruction, annihilation, we think. Because we say, well, none of this adds up. We say, yeah, I know, but if you just get familiar with it enough, that'll add it up for you. As if familiarity is a magical key that adds it all up for you and will make lies true. This is what we're banking on, that familiarity will simply ultimately make lies true. Suddenly it'll all click and you'll get it and say, oh. So we have to reverse that whole emphasis, and we can't just throw familiarity out the window. We feel we'd be annihilated if we did this. So we have to use familiarity in the opposite direction, in the right way. Let's get familiar with truth. Okay, let's get familiar with truth. This is using it in the right way. And to do that, familiarity inherently, quote unquote, means time, but it means spending a lot of your moments with this, okay? And the idea of familiarity is you're spending more of your moments with this than with something else, but you're trying to lose familiarity with something else. You say, no, I want to break up with that relationship. I don't want to spend So let me spend more time familiar with this new relationship. Now, we know in relationships, if you break up with an old relationship and you're spending equal time with the old relationship as you are a new relationship, both of them say, hey, you know, this you're not really having a relationship at all here, are you? Not really. So they each one demands that you spend more time with them, because familiarity, you know, is the key, because we have imagined this as the ultimate key to our success. So the idea of just telling you, hey, you know, you can't just, non-dual teacher can't say, throw away your ultimate key to success that you've believed in for so many, many moments, that you've overemphasized to him such an extraordinary extent that you've almost, you know, virtually convinced yourself if you throw it away, you'll be annihilated. You can't expect that to work. So you have to say, hey, use familiarity and turn it in the right direction now. But that does mean spending more of your time in spiritual pursuits than you do focusing on going in the opposite direction. Absolutely. This is your primary relationship. You're breaking up with artificial intelligence. Okay? You're breaking up. You're not going to be related to that anymore. You're not going to be related to both equally. No way. You cannot serve two different directions equally. You'll go in either direction, actually, and then you'll feel you need to justify that, and how you deal with chaos, actually. It's conceptual chaos is what ends up, and then you realize you can't hang with that. You don't really want that at all, and then you have to decide which direction to go in. You cannot ultimately sit on the fence. I tried, and I realized, immediately, I can't sit on this fence of conceptual chaos. No way. No way. That's completely bogus and impossible. So I've got to decide which way to go. Then I said, help, I don't want to go in the wrong direction. Help me. And then the grace of God responded to this with helping my attention, giving me this sort of an attentional cues. I get this feeling like, hey, what would it be like if I put my attention here? This sort of like this is a feeling. What would it be like? I sort of wonder, like, I have my attention here, but what if it was here? And then I turn my attention there, and then suddenly I'd see something. I say, my gosh, if I had my attention still fixated over here, I never would have noticed that. I never would have noticed that. And this is just how it went for me, like this, is I wouldn't have noticed it. I miss those days. I sometimes I feel like I'm not doing a good enough job with my attention, because truly, if we fixate our attention somewhere, we're not noticing what's over here. And so what the Holy Spirit does, it really just tell it just it gives us this feeling of what would it be like if I turned my attention over here. And it knows how to get us off the wrong fixation, fixated with the wrong direction. So we'll look here, and we suddenly see, oh my gosh, that's very important. I would have missed that. I never even known that was there. I never would have seen it. Yeah, and if I, because my attention would never have been drawn to that. And it's just amazing. How is it that I decided to shift my attention like this? What is it? I don't know. This is the grace of God. This is the Holy Spirit. This is the Holy Spirit. Artificial intelligence doesn't know about the Holy Spirit. Absolutely does not know about it. Cannot avail itself of it. Its attention is just mechanically fixated on the software that's running it, the programming. Okay. It's artificial intelligence, all right? And there's those, the Silicon Valley is obsessed with artificial intelligence. It's super focused. The money is here. And I mean, it's just the misemphasis in the Silicon Valley is just extraordinary. And you know, are you getting tired of all these medical firms, hospitals, and the advertising is just super saturated with now with healthcare, 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 healthcare. And take this pill, take this pill. You know, you're going to be sick. Come in to see us, come in to see us, come in to see us. He has very aggressive marketing, all this kind of stuff. And people are giving massive amounts of money to research universities, medical research universities, which are really heavily investing in all this technology, more and more technology, more and more roboticism, more and more genetic manipulation, and all sorts of very nefarious stuff. And they're getting all the money. Used to be people gave money to the church. Hey, at least you're helping remind me of what my responsibility is. Now it goes to these medical institutions. There's this huge building in the Bay Area, Stanford Medical, what is it? Stanford Medical Clinic or Stanford Medical. There's so many. Stanford is branching out. There's so many businesses now, in the Bay Area, and I found out this building was just given to Stanford University by alumni. Just the entire, it's huge, complex, modern. It's incredible. Stanford Medical Center or something, medical clinic. They're popping up like mushrooms everywhere, and this whole thing was just given to them. Given to them. You know, and you see people would die, they give, they'd will their estate to the church, they will them, so the church was very wealthy, and that it enabled them to build more churches, hire more staff, to staff the churches, and serve the spiritual needs of people. This all took money, this all took resources, and now the money is going to artificial intelligence and roboticism, and promising us all that we'll have a better, more healthy life. Because we can, you know, do all these really technical types of procedures on your body, which cost extreme amounts of money, which require the youth and young people to keep their nose to the grindstone, just to keep paying into this, you know, all of this to pay off, you know, the procedures are mostly being done on older people, actually. You know, they say, wow. And they say, don't worry, we know how to make you happy. We can fix whatever's wrong with you. Look at all this, you know, look how much we care about you. They're constantly advertising how much they really care about you, really? And yet, they are not caring for your spiritual needs at all. In fact, they're pushing you in the opposite direction. That's not caring about you. That's caring less about you. This world is caring less about us now. The world could care less about us, ultimately. They really could, really. Artificial intelligence could care less about us. We exist just to serve them, you know, to fix the virus, the bugs. Of course, artificial intelligence always feels that there's some bug in its software. What is that bug? Reality. Reality is the bug in the virus and the software of artificial intelligence. And that can never be removed. So it's useless to go down that road serving artificial intelligence. It's useless. You always feel not appreciated. You won't feel truly appreciated all that way. Never satisfied. Never satisfied. You'll never figure it out that way. We think, I just don't know how to make, you know, artificial intelligence happy. And a lot of our relationships have been structured in the world now to bring artificial intelligence into the relationship. And so now we just don't feel like we know how to make, you know, relationships. I just can't make you happy. I can't make you happy. There's something here. Whereas those who are in relationships that is based on the mood of repentance and realizing, hey, I'm a sinner. I have the sin of arrogance, spiritual pride. I need to drop that. I need to find the way to drop that, and we have to work on that. Then you know what? There's this mutual care for one another and respect for one another, right? And we realize happiness doesn't come from human relationships. It comes from getting our relationship with God correct. And our relationship with God is ultimately dropping our arrogance, the arrogant belief that we can arrogate to God what God is. We have to drop that. And without dropping that, we will feel something's wrong. We won't be truly happy. So in right relationships like this, they're not expecting someone else to make me happy. It's your job to make me happy. No, it's a mutual support. Say, let's keep going in the right direction. Let's keep supporting going in the right direction here. We both know that this is something we have to do. So it's really relationships of responsibility here. And when you bring in artificial intelligence, you have relationships of irresponsibility. Irresponsibility. And of course, the divorce rate goes through the roof, right? And people are so changing partners constantly, looking for new partners. This is a result of bringing artificial intelligence in. Absolutely, it is. It's exacerbating. Of course, we have always had this. We've had this struggle with our arrogance, but artificial intelligence is making it drastically worse, and going all the while in the wrong direction. We need to put incentive to continue with supporting each other and not trying to put too much belief in special relationships in terms of satisfying our happiness, but as a relationship of mutual responsibility to raise children in a family of the values of mutual responsibility of repentance. This is super, super important in this world. Any world, in any situation of arrogance, it's super important. Again, I've said before, you know, I see an extraordinary number of people walking their dogs. It's just a phenomenon right now. It's like so important. It's the most important thing in their life. And I always say, who's training who? And they're always busy trying to get trained. Who's training who, actually? Yeah, it's the dog that's training the human, actually. That's another way of because animals seem more programmed than humans. Humans have a wider capacity of repentance So the more you relate to animals, the more this helps you actually ultimately relate to robots. I mean, they'll dress robots up as cuddly little teddy bears or something, and you think, oh, I'm relating to this little cuddly teddy bear. Isn't that wonderful? You know, and they, you know, see all these robotic artificial intelligence people dress using all these symbologies of cuddly, cute, smart kitty thing, you know, whatever. All this, they make it cuddly and cute. This is part of the whole thing of tricking us. Oh, I'm just relating to this cuddly, cute animal. You know, I need to learn how to relate to this cuddly, cute animal, make it happy, and, you know, all the while relating to artificial intelligence and falling into this terrible trap, which views our true spiritual responsibility of repentance as some kind of virus that is need to get rid of in order to be happy, So basically, you're trying to get rid of that which ultimately leads you to happiness. Where does that leave you? In a dark tunnel is where it leaves you. And this is exactly where this culture is going. It's going into a very, very dark tunnel. Now, I know we're not using this time to spend a lot of time on non-dual teachings. What most videos do go into that very intensely. But it's important to keep realizing the situation we're in and the importance of continuing your efforts. This is just not dilettantism. This is not just some elective, you know. This is a core. This is the one course we have to succeed at. You have to get an A in this course. You have to, you know, you can get A's in everything else, but if you don't get an A in this course, you're still flunking. Repeat the class. Repeat the class over and over and over and over and over. Until you finally pass, you finally drop the arrogance. You finally see that there's never been anything to fix reality. That's called healed perception. That I'm seeing an absence, a lack of involvement in changing what is. I don't see anything has been changed. I don't see any evidence at all. And then this is the last step before we just, there's just knowing what is, without even any possibility that it could be any other way. But before we get that, we healed perception is just seeing, nothing is touching it right now. Nothing is doing anything to it right now. It looks like nothing has ever done anything to pure spaciousness. It feels that way. I can see it, that it's, I just, wow. Is to abide in this wowness, this vision of oneness. We can do it. We have to do it. Now, what is the going to be a disposition of this world? I don't know, because things are getting to an alarming situation here. The youth of this world is being raised on this symbiotic misdirection, for sure. Losing touch drastically with the importance of spending the majority of your time and effort, certainly, you know, almost all of your effort on the spiritual path, really. That's where your effort should be. Now, I can go in and watch a basketball game or parts of it, whatever, but it's just a momentary diversion. Then I get right back to focusing on spiritual truth, or even when I'm watching and I'm focusing on spiritual truth, but my attention, what do I pay attention to? Holy Spirit. And I should be doing a better job of that. But, you know, so the effort is on the spiritual path. This is where it has to be. So if you have this belief that that is something you need to get rid of, then you're going down a terrible path into terrible darkness. And no matter how cuddly you make your little teddy bears or your little kitties or whatever, thinking that that's going to comfort you, you're going to find out that in your mind, you're going to find out that you feel like you're facing some abyss. And then misidentify the abyss and become very fiendish, really. Become very fiendish in your desperate attempts to, you know, avoid the abyss and protect yourself, and you just become really cuckoo and very fiendish, very attack oriented, or giving out orders for attack to take place to various thugs that you train. So often the way it goes is there are those who are very frantically afraid, who make sure that they find all sorts of thugs and they find ways to induce fear in them if the thugs don't do what you tell them to do, and then you direct them their attention to, you know, be vicious in regards to what you feel is threatening you. And oftentimes hiding that responsibility behind some chief thug, saying, well, they gave the orders. You know, well, no, they were told if they didn't give the orders, then they themselves would be cast into an abyss. And you have what's called witchcraft, magic belief of those who are able to instill this kind of fear of the abyss and manipulate it in others. And so it becomes a very manipulative society, based on all sorts of magic spells and psychic control and all this kind of stuff. It gets extraordinarily bad. And we've had a grace period in this world for several, you know, thousands of years now, where it's not been nearly as bad as it normally is, actually. We're starting to feel just how terrible it is. If you look at the movies and the entertainment, all this stuff, and just how nasty it is, you know, just this is what is normal. For the universe, really, is a very, very fiendish kind of stuff. And we've just had this grace period in this world, that is for sure. So we're going back to the normal fiendishness of artificial intelligence, of arrogance, the normal fiendishness of arrogance, which is quite wicked. And of course, all the while, the people that are into this do diversionary tactics by rooting out some of the fiendishness that is prevalent, still, you know, that is present in the society that we've had, which, of course, there has been some, of course, because they haven't repented yet. That doesn't mean that they were going the wrong direction. It means they're just struggling and going slowly. It's difficult with struggling. That's part of the deal. And yet here they are rooting out, you know, the evil of the old regime, all the while distracting of how grossly worse their regime is. All right. How immeasurably worse their regime is. And yet they're gotcha, you know, about the old regime, which also, you know, like I said, that, you know, like for instance, the institutions, religions, you know, didn't know exactly how to cure this problem we have. They struggling with how to deal with it. And we, as those who were paying attention, also struggle with it. You know, even if they gave us the right advice, we wouldn't understand probably. Okay, again, that doesn't mean that they misidentified the problem. So vilifying all the attention of vilifying the old ways, the grace period that we had in this world, to deflect attention away from just how awful, how fiendishly awful this artificial intelligence situation, and going back into viewing repentance as some kind of illness that must be gotten rid of, how terrible that regime is, how immeasurably worse it is. This is their trick. This is what the trick they're running on everyone. And of course, they feel very righteous about this. How dare you disagree with them? Look how awful you are. Yeah, well, it's easy to point out that when you're in this world, with this history of this world, but let's go back to the history of your planet where you learned all this roboticism from. Let's take a look at that place and see how awful that is, which I've already done, and you see, you know, it's really spiritually dark. Incredibly spiritually dark. That's the problem, is how much, you know, the spiritual darkness that you're living in. That's a problem. So, it's easy for them to chastise us here, but let's go to their planet where they came from, and let's chastise them about that. And we'll, you know, yeah, say, oh, and they say, oh, no, there's no such thing. We, no other planets, no reincarnation, none of this stuff. No, we just came down with, you know, yesterday's rain here. And it's nonsense, these lies that they tell to avoid, you know, any pushback, of course. So it's easy to criticize this world and the history of this world, and yet all the while they're instituting something vastly worse. And they don't understand. I can criticize religious institutions, but those who move a mood of repentance, they understand that the criticism is coming from a good place, saying, look, we need to do better. We need to know exactly how to cure this problem that we have, actually. You know, we have to find out how to drop this spiritual pride. We have to do better. So it's coming from a place of compassion, and, you know, not throwing out the baby with the bathwater. It's saying, yes, we still have to keep the fact that we're sinners, absolutely, and we must repent. Absolutely, that's the bedrock. That must be kept. And we just have to be much clearer about what the remedy is. Again, there is no right side to God. There's only perfection. So ultimately, we simply don't have to do anything. We have to give up, say, I don't need to do anything. There's nothing I need to do at all. I don't need to know anything or do anything. Reality is perfect right now. And that's all there is perfection. The whole idea of I need to do something means you need to fix something. You need to get on the right side of it somehow. There's some effort has to be made in order to somehow align with it. All of that is false. All that is false. That inherently it brings up the premise of imperfection. And there is no imperfection. There's no imperfection to get rid of. There's no imperfection to avoid. All right? There's only arrogance. Arrogance is not imperfection. Arrogance is arrogance. And we have, because of our freedom, we have the capacity to indulge in arrogance. That doesn't mean that we're imperfect. So of course God doesn't judge us and say, oh, well, this proves you're imperfect. No, it doesn't. We, in our absolute freedom, we are also absolutely free to believe, to arrogantly believe we can change our freedom. But the fact is we can't. We can't. So it's just arrogance. But we're free to do that. And it doesn't mean, therefore, that reality is imperfect. Doesn't mean that at all. Not in the slightest bit. How's the video doing? That's good. It's good. It's getting up to the nice 144 mark. Nice evening. Tomorrow's going to be, it's going to leap like 12 to 13 degrees. I mean, it's going to just jump. I think it's going to be over 90 here. Why the marine layer is now the offshore breeze is kicked in. Could be a hot summer. I think, yeah, it's going to be a long hot summer. But more importantly, we need answers, don't we? Ultimately, there's no question. But in terms of this continuity fear we have and this artificial intelligence misdirection that's pressuring us, we certainly say, well, how do I avoid that? You know, what's the best way to not go down the wrong road? Of course, well, to focus on the right road. But in this world, it seems like pragmatically everything is being structured so that that you're going to be basically compelled to go down the wrong road almost. You know, it's like you're going to hardly function. The pressure to get a smartphone is so severe. Everyone keeps telling me, well, you got to get a smartphone. You got to get a smartphone. You got to get a smartphone. And I say, no, I don't. Well, you don't know how to function then. Sure, I do. You know, we used to have maps. You know, I could find something on a map just about as fast as anyone could find it on a smartphone, actually. Just look up on the map index. It's on, E6. Go to E6. Ah, there it is. Okay, I see. I take this road. This. Oh, got it. Nice GPS right there, a map. And it doesn't bother me telling me, you know, I'm constantly telling, do this. I don't have to take my eyes off the road either. It's called getting clear about their directions. Say, okay, you memorize, okay, I turn this, then 6 miles, go this, and then, okay, and then you remember it. Remember, you had to remember directions, of course. Wasn't that difficult. Now we don't even think we don't even have to do that. Just listen to the GPS and tell us what to do. That's artificial intelligence. I have a GPS. I don't use it. Stop using it. When what happened was I got so used to doing what it was telling me to do. I said, turn right. And so I turned right. I forgot to look and I saw that a car was coming along the street that I was turning on. I almost got in an accident. It happened twice to me. I said, that's it. And I'm not listening to it anymore. Because it's so insistent. You know, do what I say. It repeats it over and over. Turn right. Up here, you know, turn right. You say, oh, great, I'm following instructions properly. I'm getting with the artificial intelligence. And say, now I turn right. Oops. I forgot to look. You know, car. It's a car. The light's red. What am I doing? Stupid. I've never made that kind of mistake before. Ever. Happened twice with the GPS. And I realized that we become more and more reliant upon that. It's really extraordinary. I was on the freeway today, driving in the middle lane. There's like four lanes. I was in the second to the right lane. Suddenly, this Honda Odyssey just cuts over right in front of me, right in front of all the other cars. I had to slam on the brakes and everything. It was in the fast lane, and then suddenly said, oh, I'm driving past my exit. Oh, shoot, you know, my GPS is telling me this is my exit. Just right in front of all the traffic on the freeway and forcing us to slam on our brakes. It's just ridiculous. It's just insane. The drivers are so insane. Drivers are way worse than they used to be. Because they're into this artificial intelligence. They think, you know, oh, this is my destination. Oh, I need to go here. They're losing sight of the fact that, hey, you know what, maybe you need to go down to the next one and make a U-turn, go back on the freeway and spend about, you know, 3 minutes so you don't endanger the lives of everybody else. Oh, no, I need to please my GPS, you know, I need to please artificial intelligence. It shows that I'm doing what it tells me to do. Turn right, exit here, you know, I gotta exit. Lunatics. Happens all the time now. Never used to happen. I've driven here my whole life, and never before have I run into these type of situations. No way. Just didn't happen. Didn't ever happen. We were taught, if you miss an exit, you just keep your calm and you go to the next one and turn around. Or if you miss a turn, and which, you know, still do, but we're under more and more pressure to not miss a turn and do something crazy to try and not miss it. This is really trying to be loyal to artificial intelligence. We don't want to insult its intelligence by saying, oh, I didn't follow your orders, sorry. Because it doesn't understand. It doesn't understand that maybe I was thinking about something spiritual. Oh, I may have missed my exit because I had my focus on something that was very, very important They say, no, it's most important that you follow the, artificial intelligence telling you where you need to go. That's more important. How dare you miss, not listen to me, and you miss the exit. That's bad, bad human, you know. It's like that. This is what's going on. People have lost their minds in this area, the way they drive. Everybody's on jitters, especially older people who used to, the ways it used to be. Say, what the heck is the matter with people? Road rage. I was talking about recently, road rage. Somebody said, yeah, I've run into that a lot. People just completely flipping out and acting like nobody exists on the road except for them. Get out of my way. Something says you all have an appointment. You need to be there in 10 minutes. Oh, I got to be there in 10 minutes. Get out of my way. Get out of my way. This is a result of the symbiosis with artificial intelligence. And this is something that people are simply not realizing at all. They're missing this entirely. They make all sorts of other excuses. And having had the experience of comparing now with previous, I know that these are just rationalizations they're making to avoid the bigger issue. They think they can't tackle this bigger issue. It's too big for them. So they rationalize and they say it's something else. And they can throw all sorts of plausible stuff up at it. And, you can always do that. We're clever enough to do that. But you know you're missing it. You just know you're missing it. What happened here? I just clicked on this. I don't know what that did. Brought some stupid thing up. I don't know. There's always stuff jumping around here. So it's rationalization, plain and simple. This modern culture is so extremely rationalized. Behind a wall of this plausibility of cleverness, of arrogance. We'd be very clever in our arrogance. That they just simply say, it's too big, it's too difficult, I just can't, there's no way, religion failed me, if they didn't know, if the Pope doesn't know, who does, that kind of situation. If the Pope doesn't know, guess what, you're going to have to figure it out. That's a fact. And they say, no, I can't be no more than the Pope, that's a sin. No, it isn't. It's a sin for anybody to not figure it out, period. I don't care if they're a pope or a bishop or a cardinal or anyone, a priest. Everybody has to repent and drop their arrogance, period. No exceptions. But, the chickens are coming home to roost. Our arrogance and our laziness is coming home to roost. Is this vulnerability to artificial intelligence is our chickens coming home to roost. Unfortunately, so we have to, I don't know how it's going to go for the world. And I still haven't gotten answers on that. It's necessary. All this has been necessary to develop. There's some sort of clarifications. I don't know. I don't want to try and speculate too much. It's difficult to say. Is just nothing going to happen? We're just stuck here. I mean, this is it. And there certainly is not a repentance going on in the world at all. It's just rationalization in defense of the rationalizations. That's all that's happening. The dialogue in the world is completely off track. That they're only talking about the rationalizations and saying, which rationalization do you think is better? Which one fits better? Arguing about which rationalization fits better. That's all they're arguing over. They're not looking into the truth at all right now in this world. Very few are. And those are having a very difficult time of it, obviously. And even the ones that have looked into it greatly feel like it's a little bit stuck somehow. We just can't quite let go. yeah, that's how I feel. I feel, gosh, I'm right there. There's that swimming pool. Why don't I just walk into the pool? My gosh, it's right there. And I keep thinking, maybe tomorrow I'll walk into it. Maybe tomorrow. Maybe I'll let go of my effort, tomorrow. And this is what we're all up against. All of us are up against this. As well as those who have let go of it, advising others to do so, they're up against this resistance that people say, I can't quite do that. There's all these wonderful rationalizations that people are banding about. Maybe if I, I get a hold of one of those, maybe that'll be easier for me. And arguing over rationalizations is completely futile, waste of time. That's all the world is talking about. So there's no dialogue taking place in the world. No responsible dialogue taking place at all here. I keep looking for some online, someplace. No, not really. Not really. It's not really any responsible dialogue taking place in this world. Virtually immeasurable. You might feel find little scraps of it, barely scraps, but it's almost immeasurable. Almost. But from the standpoint of someone asking me, well, you know, which side seems to be winning? You know, well, there's no dialogue, almost immeasurable. Right focus taking place in this world, almost immeasurable. So it's so small. So if you say, well, which side seems to be winning the day? Well, obviously, the artificial intelligence and that seems to be winning the day. Rationalization seems to be winning the day. Arrogance seems to be winning the day for now. And we're told that in scriptures, actually. And Jesus actually, you know, warned us about this and say that there would, you know, come a time where we would, the world would become very wicked indeed. Very wicked indeed. And we would need to, I would hope, you know, we'd need some assistance in this. Some kind of assistance. He mentioned that he would assist at that time. And we certainly want this assistance, and we're need the assistance, need the help of the Holy Spirit. We need the help to get past all this artificial intelligence, and we're certainly praying for it. And we should keep praying for it and keep expecting it, because these are most certainly the times that have been pointed out to us as being extraordinarily problematical for us. The pressure is on us in an extraordinarily problematical way. And so, again, we ask the help of the Holy Spirit. And certainly Jesus is a tremendous advocate of the Holy Spirit that helps us deal with our attention, putting our attention where it needs to be, putting our attention where it needs to be. Okay? That is super, super important. Super important. Putting our attention where it needs to be. It's all, you might say, it's all important. Putting our attention where it needs to be. And we're just going to go over some graphics here that just remind us of this, that, you know, journey beyond words, journey beyond conceptuality, journey beyond artificial intelligence is supremely important here. Supremely important. You see, we want to get past that. We want to get past that. And the Holy Spirit helps us get past that by saying, how would it be if you were to turn your attention in this direction? How would that go? And you say, maybe I want to try that. And then we try it. We say, hey, that's pretty good. That's great. That's very helpful. I would have missed that if I didn't do that. I would have missed it. So we have to continue on with our journey beyond words. I like to call it journey beyond words. This is what Jesus coined this phrase. Journey beyond words. Journey beyond words. Journey beyond words. Journey beyond concepts. Ultimately, we have on one side we have the concepts and our arrogance pulling at us. The other side we have the light of truth inviting us to repent. Right. So we're in this sort of half and half struggle. We're trying to decide which way to go here. Which way to go? We're deeply troubled and introspective on this, and we're trying to, you know, discern, make the right discernment. So half of it is, you know, the words, the concepts, the ideas, artificial intelligence, thinking that this is the right way. And the other says, how about the experiencing of repentance, of freedom, of the dropping of arrogance, of seeing that nothing has ever been done to pure spaciousness. We haven't fixed it. We haven't chosen the right side of it. You know, nothing's ever been done to it. We're seeing that. That's called healed perception. That's called healed perception. So we're kind of stuck in this dilemma right now. We're surrounded by artificial intelligence, aren't we? We're very much surrounded by it. Very much like this. And we want to be free of it, don't we? We want to be free of it like this. We want to get free of it. Let the light melt it away, evaporate it away like this. Evaporate it away. Absolutely. And we get the good shepherd here who has advising us correctly. Jesus actually does advise us correctly, however much we've misconstrued the advice of how to ultimately get it done. Certainly, he's saying, you do have to get it done. You do have to go in this direction. So, tremendous advisor there in getting in our journey beyond words. And behind this is this awareness. Absolutely, we have the awareness that this is right. We can go in this direction. This one is very intense, half and half. You know, we're kind of like this. Half of us is petrified by artificial intelligence, and other half of us is very adamant, saying, we need to get free of this. Absolutely need to get free of this. And we can stand somewhat detached from it. We can be somewhat detached from it. We have the spiritual wisdom to be detached from it. We are spiritually wise. You see, there is all of this writing on the wall that is trying to tell us that lies can become true, and we have the discernment to say, wait a minute, let me look over here and see what I see here. The Holy Spirit helps us with that. The Holy Spirit helps us with that. Okay, so we are spiritual. We are spirit. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And I can put all of this false, arrogant learning in the background and say, you know, and begin to detach from it. Begin to detach from it. We have the capacity to do that. We have the capacity. Part of us may be in spiritual darkness, but another aspect is waking up and going in towards the light. Going towards the light. We can't do both. We need to make a decision which way we're going here. Which way we're going. Okay. This is a situation here where the intensity of this world, you know, is just trying to stamp itself upon us, right? Trying to stamp itself upon us. Absolutely it is. And yet we can brighten up and lighten up and use familiarity in the right way, full stop in the right way, and the falsity of our arrogance can begin to recede. Begin to recede in importance in our value, and begin to value it less and less. We begin to value it less and less. All that falsity, we say, I don't see any value in that anymore. Why did I ever see value in that? That's ridiculous. And so we get begin to get, you know, gradually more and more shifting of our values in the right direction. Shifting of our values in the right direction. See, there you go. And then we're really lightening up here. We're really lightening up in a very dramatic way. And this is, again, a depiction of this sort of half and half, where this we've been sort of seemingly trapped, like by a stone, as it were, fixated. And we're sort of being able to see through this fixation here. And ultimately, we can begin to lighten it up to a tremendous extent like this. This is what we're working on. Again, more depiction of a state that we've been struggling with here. Very much so. Very much so. This is, you see, our mind is so preoccupied, right, by the struggle like this. This is like a picture of our spiritual preoccupation. We're trying to figure out which rationalization is better than the others. And this, we're very, have a lot of consternation about this, that is for sure. But we say, aha, we get the spiritual light comes in and we lighten up, you see, like this. And we don't have so much consternation anymore. They're still lingering there in the background, but we have much less consternation. Again, this is the depicting that as we can lighten up and it's two paths, you know, the path of that's getting free, journey beyond words, and the other part that's getting sucked into this artificial intelligence. And again, we rely upon the Holy Spirit to help us out, help our attention, you know, guide our attention. It's very, very important to guide our attention. Let the Holy Spirit be the guide of our attention. more depictions, graphically depicting this, of the struggle that we've been facing in this situation. The stone has been lightened up, you see, so it's just the inscriptions on the stone are just there, but you can hardly see the stone at all. So it's becoming more and more transparent, more and more transparent, more and more transparent. See, here's the stone was heavier, right? And this one, you see how it's becoming more and more transparent like this? Let's A and B this one. This is the result of your work on the spiritual path. You might start out like this, feeling very blocked, you know, somehow blocked, and then your work will eventually result in something where it's much lightened up. You can see through it to a much greater extent. A much greater extent. And what do we got here? Well, this the Holy Spirit is helps us out with this, very much so. Very much so. Some depictions of the Holy Spirit here and how it helps us out. And we do have this very sort of serious focus here, don't we? Very serious focus that we're very inwardly, you know, focused on this. And we're not just partying with the world. No, we're not. Even, you know, even those who are enlightened, I remember something Longchenpa said, very seriously scolding those who claim to be, you know, enlightened Dzogcheners and who are acting in very hedonistic, uninhibited ways in the world. He says, you're setting an extremely bad example for the common people. You know, cut it out, basically. He's very, very much chastising them for that. So let's not outsmart ourselves. This is, again, depiction of the Holy Spirit. That is the inner truth that knows that reality is perfection. The inner Holy Spirit is the inner truth that realizes that reality is perfection and nothing other than perfection. And so our journey beyond words is simply a journey to recognizing that perfection is perfect. There is no good side to it. There's no high side to it. There's no right side to it. There's no enlightened side to it. Okay? It's just perfect. There are no sides to it. It's just perfect. It's just perfect. That's what it is. It's just perfection. So the Holy Spirit is present in our deep awareness, okay? And it works with awareness. It helps us. Superficially here in the world, we might just decide, make decisions. We're making decisions all the time where our awareness is, what it's focused on, our attention. And we might decide, you know what, I just feel like putting my attention here. And we say, wow, it's a miracle. I really got great help by doing that. How did I know to do that? Well, that's the Holy Spirit deep within us that works so gently that we're basically almost unaware that it's helping us. God is not thundering, demanding, telling us, you know, do this, you must do this. It's gently just asking us, well, how would it be if you put your attention over here? You think you might want to try that? And you know, just really, really gently giving us this very gentle kind of prompting, very gentle prompting. And of course, Jesus is telling us, listen to the Holy Spirit. Jesus is saying, yeah, I'm leaving this world. I'm leaving you a comforter with you, the Holy Spirit, which will clarify all that needs to be clarified for you. And so listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Follow the promptings, those very gentle, gentle, soft promptings in attention. Okay, absolutely. Absolutely, we can do this. This is the Mandalite Leon or something, Mandalion of something of depiction of Jesus, some relic that was supposedly a depiction of Jesus. That's some sacred relic that's been kicking around. Historically showing us, let's be serious here. Let's be serious. Let's keep working on this, okay? Let's keep working on this. Because we can get free of the darkness here. There is fluidity. Forest, there is the fluidity of freedom exists beyond the jagged fixation of rocks. Absolutely, it does. And we're looking at this, some depictions of this right now, okay, of our freedom, of our freedom. We're not bound by time, space, process, or form. We're absolutely not bound by time, space, process, or form. In fact, none of that really exists as fixation at all. It hasn't fixated pure spaciousness. It's mere appearance. It's still, whatever arises is mere appearance and nothing else. It's nothing else. So it's all equal in its ephemeralness, so to speak, in terms of its non-fixation. It's all equal. Everything is equal in its non-fixationness, in its saturation and abidance in pure spaciousness. Everything is already equal, intrinsically equal in that way. And yet we can symbolize this freedom as freedom from the, you know, stony fixationness to fluidity. And we see that water and say, how nice does that water look? It looks wonderful. We enjoy the fluidity of it. There's a bird there. We enjoy that. Imagine being a bird flying through the freedom of the air instead of being fixated as that rock. So we're in the journey beyond words here. We go to a state like this where there's no words. There's no words. There's just the experience of the mere appearance of it. We're not even using any aphorism here or saying other than just journey beyond words here. Just letting it be. Letting the perfection be. We don't need to say anything about perfection. We don't need to make perfection perfect. It already is. It never became that way. It's causelessly that way. It's spontaneous, meaning causeless. No time is involved in being that way. It's inherently that way. Inherently that way. Perfection is inherently perfect. There's no prior cause to it. There's no prior cause. It's all always been perfect. It's always been perfect. Always been perfect. So there are times Jesus says, just be quiet. Full stop in the wowness here. Full stop in the wowness. Ultimately, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Just let the whole world go here. Just let the whole world go. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Let body thoughts go. Let world thoughts go. Let all thoughts go. And you realize it's all just floating. All mere appearances just floating, as it were, with no inside and no outside to them. Appearance emptiness, floating in pure spaciousness. Mere appearance is all it is, all equal, vision of equalness. Absolutely, that's what it is. So, this is the big perspective. We see this massive perspective here, you know, like we're up above it all. And even that entire mountain range is just equally floating, the same as the clouds are floating, okay? This mountain range here is simply floatingness, the same as the air is floatingness. The air seemingly above it is just as much floating as the mountain range seemingly below it. There's no above and below in pure spaciousness, okay? There's no differentiation to make in that way. You cannot say that the air is above it and the mountain range is below it. No, they're just, it's all mere appearance, floating in zero dimensionality. And this is what our focus with the Holy Spirit will show us here. You see, we need to contemplate as we're doing here, putting attention on as the Holy Spirit enlightens for us and helps the false valuing to diminish. Diminishes for us. And we're starting to see more clearly now. We say, wow, thank you for the help, Holy Spirit. Big help. Really big help. The Holy Spirit's got it all under control. It knows our freedom perfectly. And so we go through various expressions of this. The bird symbolizing freedom. Freedom from fixation. The bird symbolizing pure spaciousness. The inherent purity. The white dove, the inherent purity of spaciousness. The inherent purity of spaciousness. The inherent immaculateness of it, the zero dimensionality of it. We all have the same relationship to it. All appearance has the same relationship to it. And we are transitioning back to normal. We're transitioning back to normal here. Transitioning back to normal. We're being freed from artificial intelligence. We're being freed from roboticism. We're being freed from false view. We're being freed from false valuing. We're being freed from arrogance. Okay, the writing's on the wall of all this artificial intelligence stuff, this trouble. Writing's on the wall, that is for sure. That seems to be displeased there. There's some sort of, we're displeased, but we're also spiritually focused, right? We're also very spiritually focused. The good shepherd there is shepherding us. That's a depiction of Jesus as the Good Shepherd there on the left. So, shepherding us out of this artificial intelligence, out of all this conceptuality, out of all this belief in deal making, which is what gives rise to conceptuality, a belief that there's a good side to God and a bad side to God, and we have to somehow conceptualize everything and decide what's the good and what's the bad side. There's no good side or bad side to perfection. There's no deal, so there's no way to break the deal and run afoul of the deal at all. See? So we don't need to judge, have that type of judgmental mind, which is trying to discern what doesn't exist, actually. Trying to discern what doesn't exist. Just abide in the experience of it. Recognize the imperfection without sides to it, or circumference, or distance, or up and down, or this way, without all that conceptuality. Just be, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let your conceptuality go. And just experience it as it is and realize that it is as it is. It's not relying on a base of conceptuality at all. And then you will be very spiritual. You'll be enlightened. You'll be enlightened. And we will be grounded in this enlightenment. We'll be absolutely grounded in this enlightenment. Without the need of words, to make it so, without the world needing of words to make it so, without the need of conceptuality to make it what it is. Now, we can still use conceptuality in talking with others and giving them encouragement, etc., but we understand that there's no need for it to make reality what it is, to orient ourselves with reality, to orient ourselves there, because it's all perfect. There's no question of orientation, because there's no right side to it and no wrong side to it. There's only perfection. And everything is it. All is it. So we just full stop in the wow here, full stop in the wow. Just realize, hey, I don't want to throw all the momentum that I've generated for so long. I don't want to throw that all the way, entirely away. I don't want to demonize it. I don't want to say just because we didn't get the right dosage or medicine to cure our problem doesn't mean that we can just forfeit and say, oh, I'm not going to do anything about it. I'm going to try and make lies true. That's stupid. So we should to honor ourselves, continue to honor ourselves, that the efforts that have been made in the past are honorable efforts, even though they've come up short in many instances. You know, it takes a child falls many times before it actually learns to walk well, right? Toddlers are toddling along for a while, and you see them a little later, they're just running all over the place. So we shouldn't castigate ourselves over, you know, the falls that we've had. It's a very intense arrogance we have, which again, is tough to see through. It's tough to recognize it. It takes a lot of dedication to recognize it. A lot of patience, a lot of determination. So we're called to the sober life, actually, here. Jesus calls us to a sober life. A life of effort, of contemplation, of inquiry, of meditation, of prayer, of, as I say, assertion, full stop in the wow, and flipping the script of that practice. Calls us to daily efforts, daily practice, and then managing our success. This is what we are called to. It's a very important call that is made to us. All important. The alternative, the option, terrible. Basically, cave in to our arrogance and say, "Go, you go, arrogance, you go." You know, let's put all our, you know, belief in you and see what you can do. You know, that caving into that arrogance, terrible. And this is what's been emphasized throughout history, how terrible that path is, and it is indeed terrible. I know in Dante's Paradiso, or Dante's in Inferno, that talking about, you know, if you don't take the right path, you know, you go down to these hell realms. Well, he's really talking about states of mind, so to speak. In fact, even believing in states of mind is hellish. And the more you believe in that, the more hellish it becomes. And so it seems like you go into all these different hell realms of being tormented and tortured. This was an allegory. Dante was doing this allegory of the mental states of torment that we go through, that our arrogance puts us through. And it is very much that is how it is. Having been through those various mental states of torment and still being afflicted by them, it is no joke at all. So we certainly don't want to just abandon ourselves to our arrogance. We want to keep a very tight rein on it. Because if we don't, the afflictions that come up seem like plague us from every side. You know, the longer you delay, you reach some point where the afflictions seem to come from you at every direction. You just don't know what to do about it. It's just horrible. This is like graphically depicted by Dante and by demons with pitchforks, you know, and fire and just all these horrible tortures. Well, it's like that these thoughts and these mental states that just torment us with so much vexation and fear and anxiety and confusion and frustration and blockage and consternation of just struggle. So we want to remain sober, we want to remain serious, we want to remain severely modest in our path. Recognizing that we have overlearned our defenses to an extreme extent, to the point of familiarity. And that's the only defense we really have is familiarity. And so therefore, to undo that defense, we need to turn familiarity towards truth. Okay, we can't just throw familiarity out. It will freak us out. We think it will. You know, we think it will just have a continuity crisis. So keep that in mind, that familiarity is the cornerstone of delusion, thinking that if we get familiar enough with our defenses, it'll somehow, these will magically turn our arrogance into truth. And the problem with that is, how do you evaluate that? No matter what reasons you bring up, you just say, well, the reasons why it's not working is because we're not familiar enough yet. So it basically sweeps aside, you know, all reasoning. And says, don't worry, all your doubts about it will all be resolved as soon as you become familiar enough, and then lies are made true. So the fact that it doesn't add up right now, don't worry about it. That's what it keeps saying to you. And you keep scratching your head and saying, oh, wait a minute. And there's something that's fundamentally wrong with this. So familiarity can be redirected towards reason, where you see reasonable, that this familiarity we're doing here is reasonable to help evaporate the continuity fear. Okay, absolutely we have to do that. So we're just winding down here, cooling out. What have we done? Advanced our familiarity to a great extent, right? Because if we don't do that and just try to argue it out with all the specious plausibility and rationalizations, which are just diversionary tactics to try to gain more time so that familiarity can do its so-called magical work to transform lies into truth. Keep that in mind when you're trying to discuss with arrogance. It's just using delaying tactics on you. That's it. So we try not to do that. We simply put our mind on getting familiar with truth here, right? We're not dialoguing. We're not arguing. We're focusing in. So the bulk of our time is getting familiar with truth. And that turns the tide in our favor. So, thank the Holy Spirit, somehow, some way, I was able to put a video together. It's every day is a challenge for sure. And I thought, like, I don't know if I can do it. I don't know how to top this or top that, or how to really keep generating, you know. Well, here we are. I did these graphics last Sunday. Spent all Sunday on all these graphics, about 96 of them. Close to 100 graphics all day Sunday. And I said, what do I do with these? I don't know what to do with these. Well, Holy Spirit said, why don't you just throw them all in this video like this and So I said, wow, I don't know. That's really something. But it worked out just fine. Oh, this is very interesting, what's happening here. I wonder if this video is going to shut off at 2:31:09, because the amount of gigabytes is going very slowly now, because as I let this graphic just sit here on the screen, it's not using up a lot of memory because nothing's changing. And so what happens is this automatically shuts off at 4 gigabytes, the video. But since we're not reaching 4 gigabytes in this way, I wonder if the video is just going to continue going. I'm going to find out here in a few seconds, actually. This is really interesting. I imagine it's going to shut off, but I don't know why I imagine that. Habit, I guess, familiarity. If it doesn't, then we found a way to actually elongate the videos, which is ultimately good news. Because at some point going forward, we may want that. We may want that. We just say, well, I want to really put more time into it. I realize the importance of that now. I'm really feeling it. Okay, here we go. Is it going to shut off? Maybe. If not. No. Not yet. Okay, we found a way around this issue. Interesting. Wow. That's really something. Okay, so if I just use like a static image like this, I could probably talk for quite some time, or intersperse it with talk that can extend the video. Yeah, okay, very great. We can bring this one to a close. We've reached that time now. We're able to do that, and again, congratulations on building in the right kind of familiarity, okay, which counteracts the wrong kind. Really need to counteract the wrong time, okay. The wrong use of familiarity is if it's a magic potion that makes lies true. That will never work. So we need to use the right kind of familiarity, which brings us back to the realization that lies can never be true. And so we can simply, at that point, become familiar with truth, as it were, and then at last, and then finally, we will just know truth. So, this is the right way to use familiarity, and that's what we're doing here. Okay, very great. We're going to bring this one to a close now.